Short Books, an imprint of Octopus Publishing Group Limited, presents How to Be a Bad Birdwatcher. Embrace the everyday joy of birdwatching to the greater glory of life. Written and read by Simon Barnes. To my father, the first bad birdwatcher I ever met, he taught me all he knew. I am but mad north-northwest. When the wind is southerly, I know a hawk from a handsaw. Hamlet. Forward. Every now and then, sometimes by way of an email, sometimes when I'm giving a talk, sometimes during a chance meeting at a nice wildlife spot, someone tells me, "You changed my life." The book most often blamed for changing lives is this one. I wrote it 20 years ago, beginning with the sentence, "I am a bad birdwatcher." I still am. I'm a lot better than I was when I wrote the words that follow. These days, I might even claim to be a good bad birdwatcher. True, my field skills are still ropey, especially when it comes to plumage details of distant waders. But I'm sort of okay, especially on song and call. And when it comes to enjoying birds, I'm still world class. Always was, always will be. You don't need to be brilliant at the minutiae of diagnosing species to be a birdwatcher. You don't need to chase rarities from Fair Isle to the Scillies and build a British list beyond 400 species to be a birdwatcher. You don't need to have kept records of your local patch for 30 years to be a birdwatcher. All you have to do is watch birds. And if you do so, you will fill your life with a richness that it didn't have before. The book began in the column I write for the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds, the RSPB's magazine. Even then, I've been writing it for a dozen years and I'm still at it. I had just learned that very few RSPB members call themselves birdwatchers, even though they all, by definition, like birds a great deal. So I wrote a piece saying that we are all birdwatchers. Just look out of the window, find a bird, watch it for a bit, and there you go. Free yourself from labels. You too are allowed to enjoy birds. The piece struck a chord. "Biggest response we've ever had," said the then editor, Rob Macklin, a seriously good birdwatcher. So I wondered if there was a book in it and wrote a proposal. 2 or 3 months later, my beloved agent, Georgina Capel, gave me the dismaying news that every major publishing house in the country had turned it down. "But don't worry," she said, in her uniquely confident tones. "We'll have to go smaller, but that might turn out to be a good thing." It did. A company called Short Books took it on. They produced a smashing-looking book, and it started to sell. And sell. And like a poker player smelling a run of luck, they went all in, where a major company might not have bothered. And glory be, we had a Christmas hit on our hands. So many thanks to all who bought one. But it didn't actually change anybody's life. It was the birds that did that. All I did was point at them. People looked, and the birds did the rest. Somewhere in the writing, my father elbowed his way in. And once in, he wouldn't shut up, as was always his wont. So this became a father-son book as well as a bird book. He died in 2021, a bad birdwatcher to the end. On his deathbed, we discussed the peregrine that perched on a chimney across the street from him in London, the feeding frenzy of gannets we'd witnessed on a week-long walk in Cornwall, and of course, my mnemonic for the song of Chetty's Warbler. You will find this later in the book, and if it gives you 1/10 of the pleasure it gave my father, I'll be pleased myself. I now live in Norfolk, where I manage a few acres of marshland for wildlife, especially birds, and when I sit at my desk working at my next book about wildlife, I can see marsh harriers and hear, yes, the song of Chetty's Warblers. Birds have enriched every day of my life in ways impossible to express, still less to quantify. And it's easy. So easy to enjoy them, if only you allow yourself to do so. Look on this book as a door, one that I courteously open for you, and as you step over the threshold, I, though not wonderful myself, point at something that really is wonderful, inviting you to look at it and listen to it. After that, I invite you to congratulate yourself. You are now a bad birdwatcher. Chapter 1. Not just a nice hobby. What makes the marvellous is its peculiar way of being ordinary. What makes the ordinary is its peculiar way of being marvellous. Orhan Pamuk, The Black Book. I am a bad bird watcher. On the other hand, and taking one thing and another, when it comes to enjoying birds, I am world class. Where shall I start? With the carmine beaters of the Luangwa Valley in Zambia? With the rhinoceros hornbill glimpsed through a gap in the canopy in the rainforests of Borneo? Or with the crested orapendula seen from the press box at Queen's Park Cricket Ground in Trinidad when I was being paid to watch Ian Botham? No. Let's start in Barnet, on the extreme edge of London. I used to live there. I was going into the centre of London to meet someone, perhaps even to do some work. I wasn't looking for birds. I hadn't even got binoculars. You can't use them in a London pub, not without attracting adverse comment anyway. I wasn't looking for birds, but I'm always looking at them, you see. Not for reasons of science, or in hope of a fabulous rarity, or to make careful observations of seasonal behaviour. Just because looking at birds is one of life's greatest pleasures. Looking at birds is a key. It opens doors, and if you choose to go through them, you find you enjoy life more and understand life better. It was a nice day of early summer, the kind of day when Londoners molt into their skimpy summer plumage and men wear their jackets on their thumbs. And because it was such a nice day, I thought I'd walk past the Common to Hadley Wood train station rather than through the High Street to High Barnet Tube. It turned out to be one of my better decisions. I was going through Monk and Hadley Churchyard to catch a train that would get me to Oxford Circus, change at Highbury and Islington, in 40 minutes. And there were lots, note scientific precision, of house martins whizzing round and round the church tower. Perhaps you know all about house martins, or perhaps you think they're swallows, no matter. They are jaunty and swallow-like, and if you are lucky, they nest under the eaves of your house and leave aromatic trails down the wall and bring joy to your heart on the rare day in spring when they return from their travels. They are dapper little chaps, navy blue with white bums, and they are one of the sights and sounds of the English summer, doing things like whizzing round church steeples and catching flies in their beaks. Later in the season, the young ones take up whizzing themselves, trying to get the hang of this flying business. I always imagine the martin mother saying, "Well done, little one. You flew 3 times round the church tower. Now you've got another flight to try." Cape Town. Where was I? Monk and Hadley Church, pausing on my journey to Oxford Street to spend a few moments gazing at the whirligig of martins. It was nothing special, nothing exceptional, and it was very good indeed. Note this, one of the great pleasures of birdwatching is the quiet enjoyment of the absolutely ordinary. And then it happened. Bam! Gone. From the tail of my eye, I saw what I took to be a kestrel. I turned my head to watch it as it climbed, and I waited for it to go into its hover according to time-honoured kestrel custom. But it did nothing of the kind. It turned itself into an anchor, or the Greek letter psi, or a thunderbolt. No kestrel this. It crashed into the crowd of martins like the wrath of God, and almost as swiftly vanished. I think it got one, but I can't swear to it. It was also fast. And there I was, down on the pavement with a bag full of books on my back, uttering incredulous obscenities and prayerful blasphemies. What the hell was that? It was a hobby. Perhaps the most dashing falcon of them all, slim, elegant, and deadly fast. Not rare as rare bird addicts reckon things. They come to Britain in reasonable numbers every summer to breed. The sight of a hobby makes no headlines in the birdwatching world. It was just a wonderful and wholly unexpected sight of a wonderful and wholly unexpected bird. It was a moment of perfect drama. Note this, one of the great pleasures of birdwatching is the moments of peak experience. We humans tend to simultaneous and mutually exclusive desires, to be married, to be single, to be social, to be alone, to travel adventurously, to stay at home. Birdwatching embraces both halves of our natural desire for contradiction. It brings us enhanced enjoyment of the ordinary, the easy, and the safe, and it brings us moments of high drama and gratification and dangerous delight. Rather like life, really. And that is what bad birdwatching is all about. Life, that is to say. Let's go back to that hobby and those martins. How much skill was required? How much knowledge? How much scientific background? None, none, and none. The martins were just there, being obvious and making their merry farting calls to each other, one of the great ambient birds of the English summer. Everyone has seen martins and is aware of them at some level, even if he can't put a name to them and is unaware of the diagnostic white bums. And the hobby was unmissable, unmistakable, a great black, I saw him only in silhouette, force. It wasn't necessary to identify the bird, to know it by name. It was enough to witness a fierce and terrible drama. Any bad birdwatcher would have known it was a bird of prey, and any human being would have known it was something dreadful. Knowing its name was a luxury. It wasn't exciting because it was rare, and because I could call it Falco Sabutio, and because I could tick it and boast about it. It was exciting because it was a thrilling bird in a thrilling moment. Now I am lying here just a bit. Knowing that the bird was a hobby was a formal completion of the business. It was an explanation, a key to the drama. That is what hobbies do, you see. They turn into anchors or psies and make sudden lacerating dives into flocks of circling martins. It was gratifying to have the explanation, the understanding. But before the understanding comes the wonder, comes the delight. And that is the first aim of being a bad birdwatcher, the calm delight of the utterly normal, the rare and sudden delight of the utterly unexpected. The only real skill involved in this perfect birdwatching moment was the willingness to look. It was not skill that gave me the sight. It was habit. I have developed the habit of looking. When I see a bird, I always look wherever I am. It is no longer a conscious decision. I might be in the middle of a conversation of amazing importance about the direction of our marriage, but my eye will flick out of the window at a hint of movement caught in the tail of my eye, and I will register, bloody hell, Sparrowhawk. I might say it aloud, too, not necessarily a wise decision. I once found a questionnaire in a birdwatching magazine. It asked, "How often do you go birdwatching?" I reject the question out of hand. I don't go birdwatching. I am birdwatching. Birdwatching is a state of being, not an activity. It doesn't depend on place, on equipment, on specific purpose, like, say, fishing. It is not a matter of organic train spotting. It is about life, and it is about living. It is a matter of keeping the eyes and ears and mind open. It's not a matter of obsession, not at all. It's just quiet enjoyment. A car nut will make a quiet, unthinking appraisal of every vehicle he sees. It is part of the way his mind works. He will hardly be aware that he's doing it unless his glance is caught by something exceptional. The habit is not something to do with what he does. It is something to do with what he is. And that is what being a bad birdwatcher is all about. It is just the habit of looking. Born-againers talk about bringing Jesus into your life. This book is an invitation to bring birds into your life, to the greater glory of life. Chapter 2. Hamlet was a bad birdwatcher, and all around not to be found. Gerard Manley Hopkins, The Woodlark. Perhaps you know nothing about birds. Perhaps you even say it, well, me, I know nothing at all about birds. If so, you are lying through your teeth. It is impossible to know nothing at all about birds. Trust me, you can identify several different birds. Let's compile a list of the birds you can already recognise, even if you call yourself the most ignorant birdwatcher in the land. Robin, swan, duck, blackbird, swallow, crow, sparrow, bluted, heron, pigeon. That's 10 for a start. Now we'll throw in cuckoo, because that is the one bird that everyone can recognise on call. And you might as well add a few more. Thrush, seagull, goose, perhaps even Canada goose, kestrel, owl, pheasant, eagle, kingfisher, magpie. You can recognise a woodpecker by ear when you hear it bashing the hell out of a branch. And of course, there are plenty of birds that you can recognise from pictures without ever being in much danger of seeing. Snowy owl from Harry Potter films, puffin from the spines of paperback books, and of course, a famous grouse. And you could throw in a few exotics too. Parrot, peacock, toucan, flamingo, pelican, ostrich. True. Not all the birds in these two lists are proper species. For example, there are 3 species of swans that you can see in Britain. And please don't be put off when I tell you that there are 74 different species of cuckoo in the world. But we'll bother with species later. Let us keep things simple and talk about different kinds of birds. A swan is a different kind of bird from a robin, and if you can tell the difference between one kind of bird and another, you have already established your birdwatching credentials. This is something we can all do, as surely as we can tell a car from a lorry. So there is an awful lot of latent knowledge of birds that most people in this country possess. Birds are part of our common culture. You can concrete over the land, but you can't concrete over our minds. We have our roots in rural soil, even the most urban of us. Birds are part of our lives and our thought processes, whether we acknowledge the fact or not. We are all bad birdwatchers. It is an inescapable part of our lives. A liking for birds is quite different to a liking for stamps or matchbox labels. I find it hard to believe that people like these things in their own right. They are just a medium for collection mania. True, for some people, there are lashings of collection mania involved in birdwatching. It takes the form of making lists rather than actually collecting dead birds. But it is not necessary to be a maniacal collector in order to be a bad birdwatcher, or for that matter, a good one. I shall go on to the maniac business in due course. Let me just point out for now that the collection maniacs are not the mainstream. They are not the orthodoxy. They are not even the elite. They are just people who love birds and birdwatching and are equally ravished by an arcane competitiveness. Some are good birdwatchers. Some, but don't ever tell them, are bad birdwatchers. Yet they are all, to a man, and they mostly are men, great competitors. And good luck to them. But they are not what all birdwatchers want to be in their heart of hearts. Perish the bloody thought. Perhaps you own a car. There is a kind of car owner who goes in for mania. He will have a collector's car, a buff car, say an MGA, and he will love it and make love to it with interminable tinkerings and polishings, and he will drive it lovingly to rallies, and he will meet fellow maniacs, and they will talk about technicalities and parts, and they will talk shop, and they will bitch about the people who aren't there, and generally have a lovely time. Ordinary motorists are as much like classic car buffs as ordinary, good and bad birdwatchers are to the species of birdwatching maniacs known as twitchers. Mad collectors are all very well. As Miss Jean Brodie said, for those that like that sort of thing, that is the sort of thing they like. So let us leave the collectors on one side for the moment. The point of birdwatching is not birdwatchers, but birds. Birds have always been part of English or British life, not just as things to eat, but as part of the way we see and understand the world. Birds were even used to tell fortunes. Prediction by means of birds is called ornithomancy. The flight of a hawk, the passing of a V-shaped straggle of ducks, might be an evil sign, or it might be the most auspicious omen. In fact, the very word auspicious comes from the Latin for birdwatching. English literature echoes with the sound of birds. In the Anglo-Saxon poem The Seafarer, we hear of the plaintive loneliness of the bad birdwatcher. Sometimes I made the song of the wild swan my pleasure, or the gannet's call, the cries of curlews for the missing mirth of men. Probably a hooper swan, I'd reckon. But really, the poor seafarer must have been in a dreadfully low state to imagine the mournful, far-carrying, bubbling call of the curlew as an echo of human laughter. If you know the curlew's call, your heart has to bleed for the poor man who heard it and heard the uproar of conviviality. Hamlet said that he was mad north-northwest. When the wind was southerly, he could tell a hawk from a handsaw. This line has baffled not a few in its time, but handsaw is a contraction of heronshaw, which means young heron. Hamlet was clearly a bad birdwatcher himself, though he probably carried a falcon rather than a pair of binoculars when he went a-birding. When the wind was southerly, he could tell the slow, rhythmic wingbeats of a young heron from the flap-flap glide of a hawk. No great trick to that. Even a bad birdwatcher like the Moody Prince was up to it. Poets have always celebrated birds. William Blake said that the robin redbreast in a cage put all heaven in a rage. Gerard Manley Hopkins not only rejoiced in a kestrel in The Wind Hover, the most thrilling nature poem ever written. My God, what would he have written had he seen my hobby? But he also wrote the definitive poem about being a bad birdwatcher and his problem in telling one lark from another. Chivo, chivo, chivio, chi. Oh, where? What can that be? It's a woodlark, Father Hopkins. Lovely song, too. The bird can even sing its own Latin name, or the first part of it, Lulula arborea. The French call it l'alouette lulu. I touch on literature here, not for the sake of the poets, but for the sake of the birds and the bad birdwatchers. Birds are in our past, they are in our blood and in our bones. In short, when you make the decision to become a bad birdwatcher, you do not start from scratch. You are already a bad birdwatcher. The baddest birdwatcher on the planet starts off with a huge bank of information, tradition and culture. After that, it's just a matter of getting the habit of looking and listening like Father Hopkins, but we'll come to that later. So let's make a start on the looking side of things right now. Look out of the window. See a bird. Enjoy it. Congratulations. You are a bad bird watcher. Chapter 3. Birds are only human. 'Tis not through envy of thy happy lot, but being too happy in thine happiness. John Keats, Ode to a Nightingale. Why birds? Why not mammals? After all, we are mammals ourselves. It makes more sense to watch our own kind. Or why not reptiles, since reptiles are wonderfully unlike our own kind? Or insects, because there are so many more of them to see? Or plants, because they at least have the decency to keep still? Birds are the most studied organisms on the planet. They are the best observed, the most fanatically recorded, the most lovingly written about. Birds have more good observers than any other kind of animal, and untold millions more bad ones. Why? The answer is obvious. Because they're obvious. Birds, I mean. At the end of the last chapter, when you looked out of the window, you will have seen a bird all right, unless you were dead unlucky and in absolutely the wrong place and didn't want to look for more than a few seconds, or if it was dark and there were no owls passing by. But how many mammals did you see? I mean, wild mammals. Thought not. It is a rare and generally exciting thing to see a wild mammal. Squirrels, yes, grey squirrels in the park. Bunnies are easy enough to see too. But that's it. It's a real thrill to see any wild mammal, or at least unexpected. Not everyone is overjoyed at the sight of a house mouse, or Rattus norvegicus. When did you last see a living hedgehog? And hedgehogs, as we know from their sad, flat corpses, are pretty common. That's because hedgehogs, like most mammals, are creatures of the night. They have their being at times when we light-loving humans are just not around. Or even if we are, it's too dark to see the bloody things. And how often have you seen a weasel or a stoat? I live in the country these days and spend a lot of time outside. I saw a deer 300 yards off the other night because I was carrying an extra powerful torch, and I got a glimpse of a stoat last week. A few nights ago, a hare crossed the road in front of me and performed a spectacular can't-catch-me leap. Gorgeous animals. That's three decent mammal sightings in little more than a week. A pretty satisfying week for casual observation, I reckon. And birds? Hundreds of sightings and hearings. Birds are always around for bad bird watchers to be aware of. Wild mammals are exceptional. Wild birds? A part of daily life. Then there is the question of the number of species, of different kinds. There are maybe 20 different kinds of mammals you could hope to see on land in this country. As for birds, there are a couple of hundred easily available. The top twitchers have scores beyond 500. So birds are available to be seen. And they come in a satisfying diversity. Some of them are hard to tell apart, but you don't need to catch them or use a magnifying glass and a collecting box or kill them and use a microscope. Birds come in a great variety, but not an overwhelming variety. It is the sort of variety you can cope with, whether you are a very good bird watcher or whether you're a very bad one. Now, there is also another reason for studying birds. They can fly. Have you thought for a second how amazing that is? Flight is the dream of every human being. When we are lucky, we do quite literally dream about flying. Freud said that all flying dreams are really about sex. Perhaps they are. I've never found that to decrease their pleasure. They are the best of all dreams. You are free. You are miraculous. The desire to fly is part of the condition of being human. That's why most of the non-confrontational sports are about flying, or at least the defiance of gravity. Gymnastics is about the power of the human body to fly unaided. So are the high jump and the long jump. The throwing events, discus, shot put and hammer, are about making something else fly, a war on gravity. Golf always seems to me a piffling game, but every one of its legion of addicts will tell you that it all comes back to the pure joy of a clean strike at the ball, making it defy gravity, making it climb like a towering snipe, making it soar like an eagle, at least in the mind of the striker, as it reaches the top of its long, graceful parabola. Think about it. All these sports are done for the joy of flying. Skating is a victory over friction, and it feels like a victory over gravity. It feels like flying. Its antithesis is weightlifting, a huge and brutal event, the idea of which is to beat gravity. All the horsey events come back to the idea of flight, of getting off the ground, of escaping human limitations by joining up with another species and finding flight. For every rider, every horse is Pegasus. And birds, as you may well have noticed, fly. They fly in all kinds of ways, the brisk purpose of a sparrow, the airy insouciance of the seagull, the dramatic power of the hawk. Some birds specialize in flying very fast, others in flying very slow. Great hunters like the barn owl work on the edge of the stall all the time. Kestrels are very good at flying without moving at all. Some birds are not so great at flying. Pheasants just about get off the ground into a safe place in a tree for a night. They are poor flyers, but they are unquestionably better than us humans. And flight attracts our eyes, lifts our hearts with joy and envy. Flight, to us earthbound creatures, is a form of magic, one of the great powers attributed to decent wizards and witches throughout history, is the ability to fly from the persecuted sorcerers of the Dark Ages to the players of the game of Quidditch. And so we look to birds for a very deep-seated kind of joy. It goes back to the dawn of humankind. Ever since humans first walked upright, they were able to turn their eyes...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.